This morning we'll be looking at the topic, creating your praise memorial. Creating your praise memorial. Our text is taken from book of Numbers 10. Numbers 10, verse 9 to 10. I will read it. You can display it, Daniel. Numbers 10, 9 to 10. It says, when you go to war in your land against the enemy that oppresses you, then blow an alarm with the trumpet, that you may be remembered before the Lord your God, and you shall be saved from your enemies. Also, in the day of rejoicing, and in your set feasts, and at the beginning of your month, you shall blow the trumpet over your burnt offerings and your peace offerings. Thus, there may be a remembrance before your God. I am the Lord your God. This particular passage that I've read is an embodiment of what I call the covenant of praise. God's covenant of praise. You know, a covenant is an agreement between at least two parties. It can be more. But usually, well, you can covenant with yourself. For example, like Job said, I have made a covenant with my eyes that I will not lust upon a maiden. He made up his mind. He covenanted with himself that I'm not going to do that. But usually, covenant is usually with more than one parties. Usually two, it can be three, it can be 100. So, when we're talking about God's covenant of praise, it is what God has covenanted, or well, initially with the Israelites, that when you blow the trumpet, that I will remember you. He now said the specific circumstances in which they were to blow the trumpet. The first one was during the time of war. And you will realize that as you read and go through the Bible, the angels of God are here, don't worry. As you read the Bible, you will notice that whenever the children of Israel, they are going to war, they usually blow the trumpet. Whenever they've blown the trumpet, oh, God's mighty work will happen. Why? Because it is a covenant. And what that tells you is this: once God enters into covenant with you, God will not break it. Why? Because he says, my covenant will I not break, neither will I alter the things that I've said. That is the way God is. If you can get God to enter into a covenant with you, understand that the only person that can break that covenant is you. So in this place, God was instituting what I call the covenant of praise. That if you will praise me, if you will blow the trumpet, because the trumpet represents praise, if you will blow the trumpet upon your sacrifices, I will remember you. Then the next condition in which God said, okay, I will remember you, is says when you blow your covenant in peace time. See, there is war time, there is peace time. When is that you are going through difficulties? When is that you are going through pressure? God says, praise me. Also, when everything is fine. You know, as you know that song, blessed be your name. When all things are, it should be. Things are really going well. You are saying, oh, thank you, Lord God, that nothing is going wrong for me. That is also a good time to praise God. And see, when you look at it in life, it is either times when things are going well or when things are not going well. And what that tells you is that God expects you to praise him every time. But in case you just didn't get it in your head, that's what God is expecting of you. No, God now said, he says, look, when you blow the trumpet, you blow it at the beginning of every month. You know, I was thinking about this particular passage, and I'm looking at our church, the RCCG, that why is it that we have to do Thanksgiving every month? And I realized that, hey, it could be that although he's like the founder of the church, he said as his will when he was about to die, he wrote it and looked, look, don't mourn me, just praise me. Just praise God for me. And on that basis, Jehovah instituted for the redeemed Christians of God that every month we just praise God. So every month we do Thanksgiving. Of course, in most churches, they monetize it. Okay, when you want to give Thanksgiving, you give this. Fine, that is good. Whether with money or not money, as long as your heart is right in the right place, you do it. So
That's why we do what we do. And then I was thinking about it too. It says that not just in every month, you also praise God at your set feasts. What are the set feasts? For the Israelites, you know what Passover is. Passover is a set feast. They do it every year in remembrance. Also, the Pentecost. Pentecost is a set feast. They do it every year. They gather together as much as possible. And then also, there is the tabernacles or Sukkot. They also, it's like when they gather together in tents, they leave their houses, they now set up tents, and then they live in tents as a reminder of when they used to live in tents. God says, you should do this every year as a remembrance. And God now says, whenever even you do those things and you praise me, I will remember you. And I just thought about it when you look at our own denomination, that you know that actually we have three set feasts, three set programs. You have in March, you have the Solemn Assembly. August, you have convention. And then December, you have, not convention, what is it? The one that's coming up now. No, it's not, no. August is convention. March is Solemn Assembly. And the December one. I hope they won't sack me if they don't know that. Anyway, you know what I'm trying to say. I'm talking about that. It's like, for example, as a church now, we meet every, at least three times every year. And it could be, I realize that it could be modeled on this fact as a church. But the simple fact is this, whether we meet once every month, like let's say for a Holy Ghost service, the purpose of it is to praise God and to give glory to God. So you can see that even in the things that we do in the church, you can say that there's best biblical inspiration for it. So, but the purpose of it is that God says, every time you have any reason to meet, praise me. That is the purpose. Now, when you now look at it, okay, now we have the set feast, we have the meeting of every month. So, set feast three times a year, every month 12 times a year. That is 15 times already. Now, the Levites and the priests, there are some people, some of them, their purpose is to just praise God. They're supposed to meet every day and be praising God all the time. So, you see, what God was setting up was an unending system of praise. And he promised that every time you praise me, I will be there. So when we are talking about creating your praise memorial, the best way I can explain it, every year in this country, at the 11th hour, or is it the 11th minute, of the 11th hour, of the 11th month of every year, what do? We do remembrance. For those who died, First World War, Second World War, and all those ones since. And you know, when we do the remembrance, we don't just gather anywhere. We gather where? At what we call the cenotaphs. Wherever, I'm sure there is one for Bromley here. To remember all those who died, who gave their lives for the kind of life that we now enjoy. Why is that? That is a remembrance so that we do not forget. And God is saying, look, when you praise me, you may not know it, but when you praise me, what you are doing is that you are creating a memorial. The purpose of the memorial for us is that whenever anything happens, is that you, whenever you are going by, you say, hey, this is a remembrance of what happened this particular day or not. And you know what, something I've noticed is this, that in this country, we like doing a lot of memorials. You know, there is permanent memorial, and there's also temporary memorials. Permanent memorials are like the cenotaphs, or even somebody died and then they put a bench in the park, or they created a park for the person, just because they want to keep the name going on. But also, when you are driving around, you see some places when accidents have happened. You see that they put a lot of flowers in that place to remember somebody who lost their life at that point in time, to mark it, to commemorate that this person died. If it's somebody that they really, really miss, somebody may be doing it every year. Every year. Say, I'm not going to forget you. You know what?
I want you to understand this simple thing.
That when you praise God, or in fact, even when you curse God, listen to this, whether you praise God or you curse God, anything you do in life, you are creating a memorial. Not just for yourself, but for God. Because God will look at what you have done to reward you. He says, behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give to everyone according to how he has done. He says that in Galatians 6, 7 upwards, he says that, look, God is not mocked. Whatever a man sweat, that is what he will reap. So what that tells you is that anything you do, God is taking an account of it. And that becomes like a memorial. So what that tells you is this. Creating a memorial of praise is something that you have to do deliberately. You have to make up your mind. It's a choice. Say, God, I am going to, everything that I do, I want to make sure that what you remember me by will be something good. Creating a memorial of praise. So let me just go through my notes. A memorial is an object which serves as a focus for the memory or the commemoration of something, usually an influential deceased person or a tragic event. That's one definition. But another definition is this, that a memorial is a statement of facts, especially as a basis of petition. I want to concentrate on this particularly this morning. Because you see, there are two sides to a memorial. There is a memorial that remembers the past, which is what we do, we are very used to. We do it every year. But there's also a memorial that builds the future. That is what I want to talk about today. The second definition says a memorial is a statement of facts, especially as a basis of petition. And what that tells us is that even when, you see, when you are doing something, or let's say, when God has done something for you, what do? You thank God. As you are thanking God, you are building a memorial of thanksgiving, a memorial of gratitude to God. And you know what? The fact that you have built it does not mean that that is the end of God dealing with you in that sense. Because you know, there is this saying that when a child is grateful for a past deed, it's just making the way, preparing the ground for a future better deed. It's the same thing. When you create a memorial of thanksgiving for God, and God says that, this guy is grateful for what I've done for him in the past, it becomes easier for him to say, okay, I've seen the way you've praised me for what I've done for you in the past, I'm going to bless you the more. You know, it's something we can relate to as human beings. Supposing you go out of your way to bless somebody, and the next thing they do is that they start sending calls to you. Tell me, would you want to do it again? So you can look at God in that same way again. That look, if God blesses you, if God goes out of his way for you, how do you reward him? You can't give him money. He doesn't need money. But you can give him praise. And when you give God praise, you know what God will do? God will make a memorial out of it. Every time he thinks of you, he'll be thinking of what you have done. Oh, when I did something for this person, this is what the person rewarded me with. So he will now use that as the basis even for blessing you in the future. But understand this, you know, just as you can create a memorial of gratitude, you can also create a memorial of ingratitude. When you look at God's dealing with the Israelites, the reason why he could not take them to the promised land as he promised was because they were always being ungrateful. And God would say, okay, this time I will let it go. This time I will let it go. Sometimes he will let it go a bit. He will punish them until they said, all right, okay, you guys, I'm going to write you off. Why? Because they had a memorial of ingratitude. I want you to understand this. The best way to escape from a situation you don't want is to praise God. You know, in the past we talked about the escape, being an escape artist. That look, that there is nothing in life that will confront you that God has not made a way of escape from. You just have to understand that fact. That there is nothing that has no solution. There is no situation that the God cannot find a way out for you. So when you have that mindset, then when situation confronts you, you just focus and say, God, there must be a way. There must be a way that you have made for me. And because you've decided that that's going to be, that is what it's going to be. God will just have to find you that way. He will make a way for you where there seems to be none. So make sure, because it is now in your power. It is in your power to create the kind of memorial that you create is down to you. So, as I said, creating a memorial of praise is by design or default. We are all creating something, whether we like it or not. But you can make up your mind that, okay, as from now on, no more grumbling. As from now on, no more complaining. As from now on, even in every situation, I am going to see the hand of God. I'm going to see, it's like I'm going to look for the hand of God, and I'm going to see his ability to change everything and turn it out for my good. When you have that kind of attitude, it will be difficult for God to ignore you. Why? Because God understands, he appreciates our praise. He appreciates even the fact that we're able to thank him. Now let's look at just two examples. Habakkuk 3:17-19. Habakkuk 3:17-19. This is somebody who understood the power of creating a praise memorial. He says, Habakkuk, you have it? 3:17-19. It says, although the fig tree shall not blossom, neither shall the fruit be in vine, the labor of the olive shall fail, and the field shall yield no meat. The flock shall be cut off from the fold, and there shall be no herd in the stall. Now says, yet I will rejoice in the Lord, I will joy in the God of my salvation.
You know, look, this guy, he had every reason to complain. Yet he said, I'm not going to complain. I am going to thank God. I am going to praise God. Why? Can you go on?
Verse 19. It says, the Lord is my strength, and he will make my feet like hinds' feet, and he will make me to walk upon my high places.
That's the reason. He believed that God will get him out of the situation. He believed that God will turn things around. Why would God do that? It's simply because he knows that when you build a memorial of praise, something that God will look towards, you see, that will attract God to you. When, instead of praising God, you decide to complain, you decide to grumble, you know what you are doing? You are repelling God from you. You force God's hand not to be able to do what he wants to do for you. So when you understand that everything is like everything you do, you are creating a memorial, number one, and that you can create a praise memorial deliberately, and that when you do that, you put yourself into God's hand, then you know that what you need to do is to praise God all the time. The psalmist said, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. He got it. He got it. He realized that God expects us to praise him every time. Now you see, when you praise God every time, it's not just about you praising God, singing songs to God. It's about you living a lifestyle of praise. It's about you being a praise to God, doing praiseworthy things. It is when praise suffuses every aspect of your life, in your work, in your play, in your marriage, in your business, everything. When you are a praise to God, that's what God expects of us. You know that, look, God, even though my company, they are not treating me well, as far as I'm concerned, I am going to do my work for you. You know, it is when, I remember when Redeemed Christianity of God was still very young. It was maybe about 20, 30 years old. You know, there was something that people understood about people that belong to the church.
that you can trust them with your life. That when they work for you, they work with all their hearts. Why? Because they are work. They know that they are working for God, not just working for pay. To them, it is worship. It's no longer like that today. But it doesn't mean that we can't do it. When we serve God in every situation that we find ourselves, listen, I am not a minister just because I preach the gospel. That is what God has called me to do. But you know what? You are no less a minister, whatever you do. Because the things you can do, I can't do. The people you can meet, I can't meet. How are they going to know Christ if they can't see Christ in you? Or you expect, pastor, you want to push me to come and start preaching to them? You are the ones that stay with them all the time. The most I can stay with anybody is 1 hour. And I'm gone because somebody else needs me anyway. Or I need myself for two. So it's like you have to understand that, look, you are the people that God will see. That you are the people that other people will see. They will see God in you. You know what Jesus Christ said? He said, you are a holy nation. A peculiar people. So that you could what? Show forth the praise of him that has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. God wants our lives to create a praise memorial that he will see, that others will see and give praise to God. He will see and say, look, I have no choice. I have to bless you. That was Habakkuk. He said, everything that could go wrong has already gone wrong. But so what? My God is still on the throne. You know, we praise God because of who he is. God is not diminished by your circumstances. Just because things are going wrong for you does not mean that things are going wrong for God in heaven. They can't, because he is always in control. So when you decide to praise God, what you are saying is that, God, I know you are the Lord of my life. You are the Lord of my circumstances. You will cause it to, it's like to bow. And you know what? It will bow. And because you know it will bow, that's why you can praise God. You can exalt God. You can magnify God. Because nothing has been created that will defeat God in your life. Another example, David. Psalm 50, verse 23. It says, whoso offers praise glorifies me. And to him who orders his way aright, will I show the salvation of God. Whoso offers praise glorifies me. When you offer praise to God, you glorify God. When you don't offer praise to God, in your mind, what you are doing is that you are diminishing God. You are making God to be smaller than what he really is. But when you glorify, when you praise God, you are magnifying him. That's why David said, oh, magnify the Lord with me. When you magnify something, what do? You make it bigger. Even our kids know that. When you put a magnifying glass to something, why? It's because you want to see it in a bigger way. It's the same thing for us. When you praise God, it's like you put it a magnifying glass over to God and say, hey, God, how big are you? And then God will show himself how big he is. I say, oh, I used to think you are this little. But you see, you start seeing God in a big way. Praise is like putting a magnifying glass on. So it enables you to see things as they really are. You see God as how big he is, and then you see your situation, how small it is compared to God. Whoso offers praise glorifies me. And then to him who orders his way aright. When you praise God, you are making your path straight. You are doing the right things. See, when you do the right things at the right time, you get the right result. Praise is the right thing anytime. Then you will get the right result. And whoso offereth praise glorifies me, and to him others his way aright, will I show the salvation of God. God has promised. Say, look, sometimes when you are in this situation and you don't know where to go, you don't know what to do, you just start praising God. God says, I will show you my salvation. I will show you where you need to go, what you need to do, how you are going to get out. That is how it is going to be. But when you start complaining and complaining and complaining, God cannot do anything. Why? Because why should he? You've already told him that it's nothing to you. But when you praise him, you're saying, God, you are all I have. You are my king. You are my Lord. And of course, God will say, oh, yes, I am. Then let me show you. And God will show you. So we're talking about a memorial. A memorial as a statement of fact especially as the basis of petition, is that you are actively seeking to influence the outcome of an ongoing case. You know, when you're talking about memorial, it's something that you do in the legal context. When you want to put your point across, you write it as a memorial, and then it's like you're arguing your point. The same thing. See, when you praise God, you know what you are doing? You are presenting to God the reasons why He has to bless you. If you look at memorial in the past as something you can't do anything about, because once a memorial is there, it means that it is a memorial is put up after an event. For example, we mark the past soldiers that have died. We can't bring them alive again. We can only appreciate what they did for us. It's the same thing. Sometimes when God blesses us, He's blessed us. There isn't much we can do about it. But one thing we need to understand is the simple fact that, see, you may not be able to control your past, but you still have today and you still have the future. When you memorialize your praise, you are building a foundation today for the future you want to have. So when we're talking about memorial being, is like something is that you want God to do for you. You are laying the foundation today. Say, God, I am praising you today. I'm exalting you today. Why? Because I know that you are not finished with me. I'm going to build a memorial for you because I know, Lord God, you will not leave me. I know you will get me out of situation. Somebody that did that was Abraham. The Bible says that Abraham did not grow weak in faith, but he hoped against hope. Why? Because he was sure that he that has promised is able to fulfill. The Bible says that he is like his faith grew strong as he gave praise to God. Abraham believed that God would do what he said he would do, even though he hadn't done it. So what did he do? He started creating a praise memorial. It's like you setting up an altar. It's like a praise altar before God. I said, God, in this place, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to honor you. I'm going to glorify you. I'm going to give thanks to you. Lord God, my mindset is that, Lord God, I trust you, that you that have promised, you will fulfill your promise. You will not leave me alone. You will not. It's like when you start saying that, you know what? You are connecting with God. You are glorifying God. And God is pleased with you. And when God is pleased with you, the Bible says that God has pleasure in the prosperity of His people. Then He will prosper you. The Bible says that God inhabits the praises of His people. When the person who inhabits your praise has pleasure in you, what else do you want? So I want to encourage you, as maybe we may or might not have finished this particular series, that choose a deliberate action to create a praise memorial in your life. Give God a pretext, a reason to look into your life and say, hey, I am pleased. You understand? When you don't praise God, when you complain, whenever God looks at you and He says, oh, still complaining, you can stay there one more year. But when you praise God, you know what will happen? He looks at us, this guy is still praising God. Even after I left him for 10 years, okay, let's do something for this person. I am not God, but I have been able to understand this is how He works. When you praise God, you put yourself in a situation where God is able to bless you. But not just that. The blessing starts from the time you start praising God. You know why? Because it means that you don't have to worry. The Bible says, do not be anxious for anything, but in everything, with prayer, supplication, and thanksgiving, you make your request known to God. When you are praising God, and you are really praising God from your heart, you won't have to worry. You don't, will this ever happen? Will that? No, you know it's going to happen. Why? Because you are creating your praise memorial. God will have to look at that and say, I can't let this person die without blessing me because they have done what they're supposed to do. I will do what I want to do. So I want to encourage you this morning. Let's stand up. I want you to make up your mind that, God, today I have heard your word. I now understand what it is to create a praise memorial. First, I am going to thank you for what you have done for me till today, the fact that I am standing, Lord God, I give glory unto you. The fact that I am not sick, Father, Lord God, I bless your name. The fact that, Lord God, I can eat, Lord God, I thank you. Lord God, the fact that I can raise my hands and jump, I can move my legs, I can move my feet, I can just bless you, Lord God. Lord, I'm not taking it for granted. Lord, I create a praise memorial for you today. Lord, I bless you, Lord God. I magnify you. I give you all the glory. I give you all the honor. I give you all the praise, oh Lord God, because you are the Almighty God. You are the El Shaddai God. You are the King of glory. You are the King of kings. You are the Lord of lords. You are the Prince of peace. You are the I am that I am. You are the great I am. You are the Lord of hosts. Lord, I bless you, oh Lord God. Thank you, Lord God, that I am alive. Thank you, Lord God, that I can praise you. Thank you, Lord God, that I am well. Oh, Lord God, thank you, Father, Lord God, for my family. Thank you, Lord God, for my job. Thank you, Lord God, for every blessing, Lord God, that you have given me. Thank you for everything that has made me today, Lord God. I give you glory, Lord, in Jesus' mighty name. Oh, Romoto Sondo Shkere Sakaba. Lakurumoto Sondo Koshkere Sakaba. Eremata Sondo Koshkere Sakaba Shkere. Romoko Shkere Mataka Sako Shkere Sakaba. Okama Shkere Moto Soko Shkere. Bakurumoto Soko Shkere Sakaba. Why don't you thank God and say, Lord God, I bless your name, O Lord, because I am a work in progress. Lord God, you are not finished with me. Even though I am not where I want to be or where I hope to be, Lord God, I give you all the glory, Lord God, that I am not what I used to be, or I am not what I could still be in the negative sense. Lord, I bless you, O Lord God. I magnify you, O Lord God. Thank you, Father God, for all that you have done, for all you are doing, and for all you do. Lord, I give you praise in Jesus' mighty name. O Romatasana Kashedia. In Jesus' mighty name, you are afraid. When you praise God as a memorial for what He's going to do, what you are saying is, Lord, the Bible says, He that has begun the good work in you, He will what? He will complete it. So, you are now going to say, Lord, I have thanked you for past deeds. Now I'm going to thank you for your future blessings concerning my life. Because, Lord, wherever I may be today, this is not my end. Whether I like who I am today or what I am today, Lord God, Father, Lord, I still know you've got things in store for me. And especially if I don't like the way I am at this point in time, I know you've got better things for me. So, Lord God, I am going to create my praise memorial to you. And I say, Lord God, I thank you because, Lord, you've started with me. I know, Lord God, that whatever you start, you always finish. So, Lord God, I know you are not finished with me because I am still breathing. I am still standing. Oh, Lord God, I thank you, Father God, for the blessings that is going to come into my life, for the many, many, manifold blessings. Oh, Lord God, you said you will do exceeding abundantly above all that I can think or imagine by your power that is working in me. Father, Lord God, I bless you, Lord God, for the blessings, oh, Lord God, that I am expecting. I give you all the glory, Lord God, for the blessings, oh, Lord God, that I've been waiting upon you for months, for weeks, for years, oh Lord God. I bless you, Lord God, because I know I will not come face to face with you until you have blessed me. I thank you, my Lord God, because all your words, all your promises, they are yea and they are amen. Oh Lord God, I worship you, Lord God. I glorify you. Thank you, Lord God, because your word, oh Lord God, oh Lord, is forever settled in heaven. And because it is settled in heaven, it is settled in my life. Nothing shall come to shall stop it from coming to pass. I give you all the glory, Lord. I exalt my name in Jesus' mighty name. Oshkeneba sanda kaba. No toro moto soko shkene sakaba. Ekarama fondo koshkene sakaba. In Jesus' mighty name, you are prayed. The last prayer we're going to pray is this. You know, we have this tendency to view circumstances we don't like as if they came from the devil. Is that not true? That's the reason why it's like the first thing we do is that I bind you in Jesus' mighty name. That's fine. But you know, there's another perspective. If God, the God of all the earth, the God of heaven and earth, is in control of your life, is He not in control of that situation in your life? So He's in overall control. Then He knows what He's doing. Because when you are praising God, you are saying, God, I know you know what you are doing. Okay, so now we are going to say, Lord God, I want to bless you. Thank you, Lord God, for this particular thing in my life.
I know it is like you may struggle to say it, but you know it must be.
Lord, I bless you for this particular challenge, Lord God, that I'm going through. Because I know that you cause all things to work together for my good. Thank you, Father God, for those stretching experiences. For those annoying people, Lord God, that I have to deal with. Lord God, I bless you, Lord God, for bringing them into my life. Because, oh Lord God, you are going to show your glory. You are going to show your power in my life. Thank you for all those people that you have been using me. Using, oh Lord, for me to make me what I am today. You know, we all love wonderful people to be around us. But even those that are not wonderful to us, they are often the best people for us. Because they keep us the way we are supposed to be. So why don't you thank God? Say, Lord God, I thank you for the challenges, oh Lord God, that I face every day. Because, oh Lord God, you are using them, oh Lord God, to make me a better person. Oh Lord God, as I go into this week, Lord God, Father, I pray, Lord God, that your glory will shine in me. That those circumstances will bring out your glory in me, oh Lord God. Oh Lord God, will be cause me to be the praise that want me to be in Jesus' mighty name. Oh Ramata Sandushke Rikaba. Oh Kama Shekere Moto Sondokushkea. Makuru Moto Sondokushke Sandaka. Ela Karamoto Sondokushke Sakaba. Eshkiri Moto Sondushke Saki. Oh Fashankiri Moto Sokushi. In Jesus' mighty name, we are praying. Father, Lord, the entrance of your word has given us light. We now have more understanding than we used to. Knowing, Lord God, that everything we do, Lord God, creates a memorial. And also the fact that when we purposely create a praise memorial, Lord God, it resounds in heaven and causes your power to come upon our lives. Lord, I pray that none of us standing here today, Lord God, on hearing this message, will have the word stand against us. That, Lord God, from today, we shall be people of praise. Those who praise you at all times, even just as you say. In whatever circumstances, Lord God, we find ourselves, praise shall come forth out of us as a reflex to glorify your name. Lord God, as we go through life, help us to focus on you. And let us always see you in whatever circumstances we find ourselves. So that, oh Lord God, our lives will glorify you. Thank you, Lord God, for the memorials, oh Lord God, that we already have. And for the memorials, Lord God, that we are going to start creating. Because it will show and prove your enduring power in our lives. We give you all the glory, honor, and praise. For in Jesus' mighty name, we are afraid. Amen. Amen.